Well, good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church. We're so glad you've decided to join us here today. We've had some great weather this weekend, so we're going to stand and sing hymn number 6, How Great Thou Art.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Send him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart! Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Bow with me in prayer. What an awesome moment, O God, to be able to come to this place with your people to worship and praise you for the great God you are. Through the precious blood of Jesus, you have invited us to come as your children to praise you and to adore your name. So as we meet in the name of Jesus, we pray, O Holy Spirit, that you will move in our midst, touching this hour, that everything that is done and said would honor the name of Jesus, in whose name we pray, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. What a privilege to welcome you here this morning, and if you're a guest among us, as we gather each week to worship, we're privileged to have guests with us. We thank you for coming, and I hope you'll sense the love of Christ, you'll sense the warmth of our people, and you know how deeply grateful we are you have chosen to be a part of the family of faith meeting in this room today. We thank you for coming to be with us today. We're honored indeed to have you. We're privileged each year to be a part of the Operation Christmas Child Ministry. It's a great opportunity to touch boys and girls around the world. Susan Haney, who is leading us this year, has found out that if you're interested in going to Atlanta to be a part of the processing center of getting boxes in already, December 1, December 4, December 7 will be an opportunity to go. The hours will be on from 1 o'clock to 6 o'clock. If you'll simply call the church office if you're interested in going, Susan will arrange that if you'll call by October the 30th. Many of you have already gotten your boxes. You fill them out. You've already brought them back. We love for you to do more. The privilege of opening these, of filling these boxes with things for these boys and girls is an awesome privilege. As we see these videos each week, it's incredible to see the response of little boys and girls around the world to something so simple as a shoebox. But with that shoebox, the love of Christ is shared. So when you and I fill those boxes, we're giving the opportunity to share Christ around the world. You'll be blessed by what you see in just a moment.
I've never been out of the country, but because of Operation Christmas Child, I am an international missionary.
You feel like you're doing your job or what God has called you to do when you see that unity of other fellow believers coming together in one common cause?
Knowing that we're making a difference, knowing that we get to make a global difference together, and it unites the local churches together, both in the States and internationally. At the same time, it's getting people locally to think globally. It's a simple way for people to think about the world, and not just think about it, but actually do something.
Every single shoebox is a child who's meeting Christ. And just remembering the importance of every box and really just leaving the rest of it to God.
The work of Operation Christmas Child is having quite a big impact.
Jesus loves you!
A box is not just a gift. In the hands of the local pastors, these boxes can be used as a tool to touch a whole community.
They never seen that someone care for them, someone give for them. When I see a smile face of a children, just like inspiring me to serve ministry.
They are not only getting these gift boxes, but they also get the greatest gift booklet that they can take home and read, that Jesus is the greatest gift of all.
From the inside, I want to say thank you for OCC, thank you for a beautiful time, so thank you so much.
We intentionally invest a lot of time in training our team in order to make sure that the gospel is clearly communicated throughout our outreach events and the Greatest Journey classroom.
We want to disciple to make a stronger foundation of empowering the new generation. They know the story of God and they can tell others by using the books.
Every shoebox is really the beginning of the journey of evangelism and discipleship, and that leads into multiplication. And the multiplication of lives, the multiplication of churches, really impact on communities and a ripple effect around the world.
You begin the process as you pack a shoebox.
We value shoebox, and we thank you for the hand who packs the box.
We're part of a team, and we're partners in the gospel through Operation Christmas Child and through Samaritan's Purse.
Paul writes in Ephesians 2, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus." Will you pray with me? Father, because of your love and your grace and your mercy, we come this morning to worship and celebrate and thank you for all you've done in our lives. Father, we thank you for saving us, because when we were dead in our sins, you forgave us and gave us life. And because of that, our future is bright in you. So this morning, we celebrate and thank you for what you've done for us because of your great love and mercy and grace. In Jesus Christ I pray, amen.
Let's all stand together and worship as we sing Glorious Day. Sing together.
Was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your saved my soul. And now your freedom is all that I know. The old man knew Jesus when I met you. You called my name and I sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, but your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, and when
be seated.
What a glorious day it will be when these are no longer needed. I'm Bill Haney, and October is Minister Appreciation Month, and we have three fine ministers that serve us. So Dr. Bush, Chris, Russ, if y'all would please come to the front. Ken Bush, our pastor, has served this church for over 40 years. Chris Wilkinson, our minister of youth, has served for over 25 years. Russ Robbins, our minister of education, has been here over 30 years. That's almost 100 years worth of experience standing right here serving this church. That's a wonderful thing, and there are few churches, if any, that would have that kind of experience in their church staff. 100 years, that's a long time. Dr. Bush, that's a lot of sermons and a lot of Wednesday night prayer meetings. Russ, that's a lot of Sunday school lessons and Friday night football breakfasts. And Chris, I don't know how many miles you've been on a Southern coach's bus taking youth on trips. So we thank you for that. Three things I want to say. One, to you gentlemen, thank you for serving the Lord. Two, thank you for serving this church. And three, thank you for loving your people. Thank you for loving us, this church family. We have a small token of appreciation that we'd like to give them in just a minute, but let's pray for these gentlemen first. You'll join me, please. Father, we're so blessed that you love us. We're so blessed to be a part of this church. And we're blessed and honored that you have selected these three men to lead us and guide us on our spiritual journey as we come closer to you. Father, thank you for these men. Thank you for their families. Thank you for the support that this church has offered these men over these many years. And Father, as we continue to strive to find people who need to know Jesus, thank you for allowing these men to lead us. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. We have a small gift here for them and their families or their wives. Chris, Dr. Bush, Russ, we've given them a gift, and so you'll know what it is because they already know because we had an 8:30 service. We've given them a gift certificate to 11th and Bay, which is a nice restaurant in Columbus that I hope they will go and enjoy with their wives in the coming days, and know that that's an appreciation from us, and I hope they feel the love from us as they're enjoying that great meal. So if you would, please join me in appreciating them.
This morning I have something just a little different than I normally sing. It's more of a spiritual / sacred heart song. So it's entitled Alone with God, and I hope you are blessed.
Oftentimes in the strain of this busy life, when the way seemeth long, I plod. I just turn aside from the toil and strife, just to be all alone with God. Oh, I love to be alone with God. 'Tis a blessed treat, happiness so sweet and joy complete. I find the courage for the way and strength for every day. Oh, how I love to be alone with God, my God. When I can go alone with the worldly crowd, or the path that they oft have trod, I will stand by the vow that my heart has vowed, just to be all alone with God, my God. Oh, how I love To be alone with God, 'tis a blessed treat. Happiness so sweet and joy complete. I find the courage for the way and strength for every day. Oh, how I love to be alone with God, my God. I find the courage for the way and strength for every day. Oh, how I love to be alone with God, my God.
Matt, thank you again. It doesn't matter what kind you sing, it's always awesome. Thank you so very much. When Matt Jackson sings, my heart beats with joy because I know he's singing to the Lord. And what a blessing indeed we have. Will you bow with me, please, in prayer? Truly, what a moment, O God, to gather with your people in this holy place where for many, many years now people have come to be alone with God. What a positive reminder for all of us of what this place is about. It's about being with you, our God. It's about being with fellow believers. It's about remembering the great cloud of witnesses already who've gone before us and who will come after us. Coming to this sacred place to be alone with God. So we thank you, Father, for sacred moments of worship such as this. You have brought us here. You have something special for each of us this day. For you want so much to guide us in our walk with you that everything we do and say would honor Jesus. So we pray now, Holy Spirit, your special touch upon this hour. You know each of us by name. You know all about us. So we pray that you'll touch us as only you can, that we'll sense your grace and mercy. For the truth is, no matter what we may face in coming days, your grace always will be enough. And surely we have faced so many uncertain days in the past few months, and there's more yet to come. But we thank you in the midst of all this pandemic and the many other challenges we have faced. We never face those alone. Your grace is enough. So we thank you, Father, for the assurance we'll be fine. It does not matter what occurs. We belong to you. And so this morning, thank you for your touch of encouragement and strength. We thank you. Every individual in this room faces many decisions daily. You know the heart of each one and the many decisions that have to be made this coming week. You have taught us in your word that if we seek your wisdom, you'll give it to us. So that the decisions we make will be good and strong. Lord, you know what each person here is going through. You know the decisions that have to be made. So I pray even right now, Lord, that you'll grant your wisdom so that each decision being made this week will be in accordance with your will, and therein will be peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's continue to worship as we sing Stand Up for Jesus. So let's stand up.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up, stand up. Trumpet call obey, for to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day, he who our men now serving against unnumbered foes, let courage rise with danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you. Ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never won. Stay the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him who overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally.
You may be seated.
Thank you. that we must live as if his coming would be tomorrow or today. For when he comes and life is over, for those who love him, there's more to be. Eyes have never seen the wonders that he's preparing for you and me. Oh, tell the world that you're a Christian. Be not ashamed his name to bear. Oh, tell the world that you're a Christian, and take him with you everywhere.
And thank you again so very much. Beautifully and worshipfully done. Thank you. Please take your Bible now and turn with me to John chapter 3. John chapter 3. And hear the Word of God as it begins in verse 16. John 3 verses 16 following. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. If someone were to ask you why God sent Jesus to earth, what would you say? Why did God send Jesus to earth? The scripture for this morning defines exactly why Jesus came. Jesus came to reveal the depth of God's love for us. Here is a plain, simple statement of fact. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Nothing is more fundamental about God than this truth. God loves the world. John wanted his people to understand that God loved a fallen world that was full of people who did not love him. It was important for the people to understand the depth of God's love for all the world. There is simply no better truth about God than this. God loves us personally. He loves us individually. And every day when we wake up, we can wake up and begin the day with this truth. God loves us. He cares about us personally. Dennis the Menace and his friend Joey are leaving Mrs. Wilson's house with a handful of cookies. Joey looks at Dennis and says, "What did we do to deserve all these cookies?" Dennis says to Joey, "Joey, it's not that we're nice, but Mrs. Wilson is nice." What a beautiful picture of how God feels. We're not nice, but God is wonderful. And he loves each of us as though there were only one of us to love. And so this morning, would you allow this wonderful truth to sink in? Jesus came to reveal to each of us the depth of God's love for us. We're very special to God. He wants us to know how much we're loved. Max Lucado is one of the great communicators of the gospel in America. He writes this: there are many reasons why Christ came, but one of those reasons is for God to say to us how fond of each of us He is. He truly cares about each one of us. There are many reasons He came, but God wants us to know. If He had a refrigerator, He put our picture on it. If He had a billfold, He put our picture in His wallet. He sends us beautiful flowers in the springtime. He gives us a beautiful sunset each morning, simply to say to us, I love you. God could be anywhere in the world, but He chooses to live in each of us because He loves us so much. Jesus came to reveal that love to us. Again, Jesus came to reveal God's intention to save us from our sin. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. What a powerful truth about God. He did not send Jesus to condemn us, but to save us. And you see, God understood the power of sin. He knew what sin had done to this world. He knew the awesome power of sin, and there was only one remedy for that sin, and that was His Son. No one else could deal with our sin. Only Jesus. And so God sent Jesus not to condemn us, but to save us from our sin. What an incredible God. He did not desire to condemn men in their sin, but to save them. Will you allow that truth to enter your heart and stay there? God does not desire to condemn you. God desires to save. God desires more than anything else for us to know His Son. He wants to save us from our sin. Here's a God we can trust. Here's a God this morning you can yield your life to and place your life in His hand. You can trust Him. He'll save you. He'll take care of you. That's who God is. That's why Jesus came. I read about some botanists in the Alps looking for a very sacred flower, a very special flower. They were walking along, and suddenly right over the edge of this cliff area, there was a little rock area, and they saw this rare flower. It was a beautiful flower. Now, these guys knew they couldn't quite get over that little edge of that cliff and get that flower. They couldn't do that. So they thought, we'd need to find a young boy from this area who understands the terrain. He could get that flower for us. So they found a young shepherd boy and said, we will give you some very fine coins. If you will go over this ledge, we'll put a rope on you, we'll hold the rope, and you get that flower for us and bring it to us. We'll pay you handsomely for that. The little boy looked for a minute and thought, I'll be right back. So in just a few moments, he came back with his dad. He said to those guys, now, you tie the rope around me now. I will go over here and get that flower as long as my father holds the rope. It's a beautiful picture of God. You see, God didn't send Jesus to condemn us. He sent Him to save us. This is a God we can trust. It's a God you can yield your life to. It's a God whom you can know will take care of you through every crisis you'll ever face. He's a God we can trust. Notice John's statement. Whoever believes in Him is not condemned. What a beautiful picture and statement of Jesus. God has no desire to cast us away. He has a desire to save us. We are either in Christ or we're outside of Christ. There's no in between. And so this morning I would ask you the most basic question I know how to ask you. Are you in Christ or outside of Christ? Now, God did not come to condemn you. He didn't send Jesus for that. He sent Jesus to save each of us from our sin. The attitude we have toward Jesus is crucial. The attitude we have toward Jesus at the moment of our death will determine where we spend eternity. We're either in Christ or we're outside of Christ. There is no in between. It was October the 8th, 1871 in Chicago. A young evangelist by the name of D.L. Moody had begun to have powerful effects for Jesus all over the country. It was announced that he'd be preaching in the city of Chicago on that night. When D.L. Moody got up to preach, he preached from a text where Jesus was with Pilate, and Pilate was asking the people, "Whom shall I release to you, Barabbas or this one called Jesus?" The people began to shout, "Barabbas!" And so Pilate looked at the people and asked, "Well, what then shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Christ?" Mr. Moody used that text for his sermon that night. When he concluded his sermon, here's how he concluded it. He said, "This question is a crucial question for each of you in this room tonight. What then shall I do with Christ, with Jesus, who is called the Christ?" "Here's what I want you to do," Mr. Moody said. "Between now and the next Sabbath, I want you to take this scripture and mull it over, and next week come back, and then we'll decide what you're going to do with Jesus." Mr. Moody said later, years passed, that was the biggest mistake of his life that night. Because shortly after that service, the great Chicago fire hit that took 1,000 people. Many of those who were in that service that night were among those who died. They never met again under his preaching. Mr. Moody said, "I will never, ever leave again without asking for a decision about Christ." And so this morning I would ask each of us in this room, are you in Christ or outside of Christ? If you're outside of Christ right now, I urge you, I would plead with you. In your heart right now, you ask Jesus to come into your heart. You ask Him to settle the issue forever so that you're in Christ and it's settled. Again, God sent Jesus to reveal to us that He will honor our response to His love. John writes, "Whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's only Son." God will never force Himself on anyone. In creation, God made a decision. Each person will be free. You can say yes, or you can say no. And so this morning I would ask you a fundamental question. How have you responded to Jesus' love? Have you said yes or no? Hear the word of God. If you choose to say no, you're saying, "I don't want God to be in my life at all. I choose to walk in darkness. That's the way I want to live." But please understand this powerful truth. God will honor that. And if you want to walk in darkness and live away from God, God will allow that. He'll not force Himself upon you. And so this morning, before you leave this room, will you make a fundamental decision? God's going to honor your response. If you say no, He'll let you go. But if you say yes, He'll receive you. And so this morning, if you've chosen to walk in darkness, God will honor that. But you can decide this morning, as the Spirit is touching your life, to say yes and come and live in the presence of Jesus Christ and experience the glory of Christ in your life. The choice is yours. Will you pray with me? Holy moment indeed, O God. Only you can know the heart of each person here. How do pray, O Lord, if there's anyone in this room who has chosen to walk in darkness, that somehow, Holy Spirit, you would touch that person's heart and cause that individual to know that you will honor that response. But this morning, how you long more than anything else for that person to come to Jesus. So may your light, O Lord, touch that person's heart so that every individual in this room could say with absolute certainty, I am walking in the light of Christ. I never want to walk in darkness. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus to save us from our sin. In your holy name we pray. Amen. As a hymn of commitment and of surrender to the Lord, we stand now to sing the four stanzas of the great hymn, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. May we stand and sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back.
We'll leave now in just a moment. May each of us remember someone will be watching us this week. They'll see if Jesus is for real or if it's just a facade. May the Holy Spirit help each of us so to live that when people see how we behave and how we speak, they'll see Jesus. Will you bow with me in prayer? We thank you, O God, for this moment alone with you, for we have worshiped. And now as we leave this sacred room, remind us our real service for you starts the moment we leave this room. In your holy name we pray. Amen. We'll leave from the back as we usually have and then go from there. Thank you.